So as our next presenter is setting up his equipment, I'm introducing him, and I hope we'll then sync on good time. So the next presenter is Andrej Miskic, and he's from Oxford University. And he's presenting work he did with colleagues at Stanford University and in the two industrial labs, Technicolor in France, I guess, and MSR, Microsoft Research, in the UK. Yes, that's right. Okay, and the work he's presenting will be on the cementing paintbrush. So, welcome.
All right. I'm going to present a system for interactive 3D mapping and recognition in large outdoor spaces. So this is a joint work with Vipavinit, Sharamizadeh, Filtor, and many other people. Recently, there has been a lot of interest in augmented reality glasses. I guess all of you know Google Glass or, more recently, Microsoft HoloLens. And applications for such glasses vary from simple tasks such as sending emails or making phone calls or video calls through games, entertainment, to very specific applications, for example, for cyclists or even pilots. Recently, there has also been interest in developing the augmented reality glasses to help partially sighted people. They are legally blind, but most of them still have some residual vision, and the goal is to increase the information level regarding the close environment. So here you can see that even a simple edge enhancement may help a lot, actually.
I'm here in a corridor with a handful of people. I was wondering who those lovely ladies in the background were, but I think they're.
So this was pretty much a camera that managed to enhance the 2D edges and display it on augmented reality glasses. And this is pretty much the current state of the art of assistive technology for visually impaired. Just 2D images with enhanced edges and regions filled by inverse depth. Reasonably simple thing, but helps a lot. And now, imagine that we could extend these simple 2D edge-based renderings into 3D models. Our work enables interactive 3D scene recognition to allow partially sighted to visualize objects of interest in 3D. Here, you can see the reconstructed 3D model and corresponding segmentation of a scene into semantically meaningful regions. So in our scenario, we assume a visually impaired user, that's the guy on the right, and his guide, who's marking the objects of interest with a laser pointer. In the first stage, the guide uses a laser pointer and labels the word. Our system then uses this data to learn the classifiers. In the second stage, the user works on his own and is navigated by our system. So here, the guide uses the laser pointer to show a new object class to the system. And now the system propagates this information into visually similar parts of a scene, and the classifiers learn this object in the background thread so that they are able to recognize these things in previously unseen environments later on. In our application, we do not want to emphasize only the edges. However, we want to recognize and segment the objects present in a scene. And here you can see actually how such segmentation looks like. For instance, red here denotes building, or green denotes tree, and so on. This is very active research in computer vision, both in 2D and 3D domain. And the main issue with this approach is that it requires a large amount of training data. And moreover, even if we had enough data, there is no guarantee that the algorithm will generalize well into previously unseen parts, previously unseen environments, or even previously unseen objects. So this can be overcome by putting a user in the loop. So then the user actually provides some partial knowledge, either by mouse, voice, or by touch, and the algorithms learns on the fly. This is quite a nice application called Pixel Tone, where user just first labels or learns the system that is a T-shirt and then is able to work with this object. As you can see, the interactions here are being done on some data captured in the past. However, in our approach, a user can freely work into any environment and interacts directly with the real world by simply painting or brushing by the laser pointer in real time, in real world. So in our system, our system builds 3D maps of large-scale environments on the fly. We support users to interactively label the world using a laser pointer. The resulting 3D models can be segmented into semantically meaningful regions, as well as the underlying 3D model can be interactively improved using a laser pointer. And we package this up in a new hardware and software platform for the visually impaired people. So here in the top image or video, you could see actually the reconstructed scene. In the bottom, you can see interactions with laser pointer. So our pipeline consists of several blocks. The input data are processed by visual odometry and laser detector. At each frame, we also estimate a dense dev map so that we are able to merge these dev maps and build a memory efficient 3D voxel representation. Also, we allow user corrections of these dev maps. So we are actually able to improve the 3D model on the fly by interaction. And then in the later stage, when we actually have the model built, the streaming render for its classifiers continuously adapts in the background thread to partial labeling provided by the user. And the final segmentation is provided by random field and on top of the random forest predictions. And now let me go into the details of each blocks. So we will start with the input data. So for input, our system uses a pair of color and infrared cameras and a standard laser pointer. These cameras are synchronized and calibrated, so the resulting images are undistorted and rectified. The cameras are attached to the Epson Movirio see-through glasses for augmented reality, and users wear laptops in their backpacks as processing units. So here you can see actually the hardware that we used. The next step of our pipeline is estimation of the camera pose in the world. So here we rely on pretty much standard feature-based approach, namely Fovis. And just in short, we first build an image pyramid and detect the fast key points described by local binary pattern descriptors. This is done independently in each image. Next, we perform sparse feature matching along the epipolar line. And to further improve the robustness, both the feature extraction and matching steps are biased by local bucketing. And after that, we perform temporal matching between the current frame and the keyframe and robustly estimate the six degree of freedom pose with RANSAC. When we have the pose, we can actually detect the laser pointer and map these interactions on the common map. So as you can imagine, detecting laser pointer from color images is quite a difficult problem. But we used for this actually the infra cameras because there it becomes much simpler. So here on the right you can see the input data from infrared cameras. These red dots are actually the laser points. Unfortunately, we cannot simply detect the highest intensity pixel to determine the laser pointer due to spurious high intensity noise that is shown here in these blue rectangles. So instead, the user initializes the tracker in a predefined area displayed on glasses. We define a local window around this point. Here, these are these green boxes. And then we actually track this patch. Since we want to keep the window as local as possible and handle large displacements at the same time, we first move the rectangle into the predicted position by the Kalman filter and detect the laser point in that window and then finally update the filter. And in order to detect to use these laser interactions, we actually detect this laser pointer independently in both cameras. Then we perform consistency check through epipolar constraint, and we also check whether the shape of the detected dot corresponds to what we expect at particle distance. And if everything agrees, we actually triangulate these points. If anything goes wrong, this block immediately switches into the redetection mode, and this is actually very important in practice because of various optical effects such as diffractions or similar artifacts that would otherwise cause many times failure of this tracking. So this is actually quite important. And actually, when we triangulate these points, we just project them on a common map. So actually, in every other frame, we are able to project these interactions back into the current frame. These are some examples how these detections and tracking of laser looked like. So as you can see in the bottom right video, we are able to actually to interact at fairly large distance, even in areas that we cannot enter. The next step is actually in order to build a 3D model, we need to estimate the dense depth map. And in our approach, we actually allow user to modify this depth map estimation, because this is a difficult problem. So the adaptive algorithm proposed by Geiger and his colleagues, this algorithm is very efficient since it performs per pixel independent minimization of costs, so it can be easily parallelized. And this algorithm pretty much in the first step detects the sparse features. These are these orange dots. And match them in a very similar way to what we did for visual audiometry. Then on top of these features, detected matches, it builds Delaunay triangulation. And then into each of these triangles is fitted a planar, is fitted a plane. And this plane actually corresponds to piecewise planar prior for the dense matching. So it actually helps to disambiguate the dense matching. And then actually the final costs consist of these two parts. So the first part, beta FFL minus FR, corresponds to matching of descriptors. And then the second part in the bracket corresponds actually to the prior. Now this is a very clever approach. It assumes the sparse features are evenly distributed across the scene and always correct in some sense. So this is, of course, not the case in the real world. However, with our laser pointer, a user can point on an object, and we simply replace the support points by the laser strokes and decrease the cost of feature matching to force the algorithm to assign our sparse yet accurate depth. So this is actually shown here. So the first image is the input image with user interaction. On left, you can see the original algorithm and original triangulation. And as you can see, for example, here are fairly large triangles that are not so accurate or not so useful. So the user actually replaces these triangles by painting on the board. And then actually we are getting much smoother and much cleaner depth, which is seen on the in the bottom right figure. Here's actually how it looks like in a video. And as you can see, the disparity is not just actually more accurate, but also becomes temporarily consistent, since the laser strokes are stored on the common map and projected into the each frame. So here you can see that actually we're getting quite nice planar surface, which we should get, as opposed to the original disparity. And when we actually have all these depth maps, we can fuse them into a very efficient 3D representation. So we rely on a scalable and memory-efficient version of the Kinect Fusion. The difference between the original implementation and ours is that the dev maps obtained from passive sensors in outdoor environments are more noisy. So we replace the ICPA algorithm by visual audiometry for pose estimation. And the last part of our pipeline is actually the semantic segmentation. So first, user, again, use the laser pointer to provide some training data to the algorithm. Algorithm propagates this information that this is a tree to the rest of the scene, and a random forest classifier adapts to it in the background thread. Then during the test time, the random forest classifier takes our 3D data, simply traverses the tree, and returns the probability distribution from leaves. However, as you can see in the right part of this image, these predictions are fairly noisy because random forest classifier predicts per voxel independent predictions without any structural constraints. So what we want to do, we want to take actually these fairly noisy predictions and smooth them or improve them with random field. So random field actually introduces pairwise constraints or pairwise edges between the independent nodes, and it actually enforces the consistency between the voxels in a local neighborhood. So we actually apply smoothness prior here. And then we use a densely connected variant optimized through the mean field inference, which is inherently parallel and hence very suitable for GPUs. And since our energy function is defined as dynamic, we can use only a single iteration per frame. And that's enough. So the inference is actually very fast and very efficient. So we are able to run all these things in real time. Now let me show you some results. So first, some quantitative results. We actually compared semantic segmentation in 2D and 3D space. As you can see here, for all classes in our data set, we improved in our 3D labeling. Here are some qualitative results. So these are the actual final videos, the final reconstructed and segmented models that users captured with interactively with laser pointer and passive stereos. And now I'm just going very briefly mention something about user experience. So we tested our system on a number of people, and in general, they like the possibility of interacting at distance as opposed, for example, to touching. They like to see through glasses because the fact that we didn't try to synthesize the reality, but rather we just augmented it with some additional information. On the negative side, we were suggested to improve the design of the headset because it was fairly heavy and not well balanced. And on software side, the main issue was drift of the visual audiometry. This was actually the main stopping point for us. And in terms of future work, there are many possible improvements. At first, this can be used for various applications. You can imagine, for example, some augmented street view data. You can imagine some guided tours and even some outdoor games. And in terms of technical improvements, so definitely it's worth improving visual audiometry and relocalization part. It's possible to add some additional modes of interaction. For example, voice prior say, hey, this is a flat wall, or this is a flat surface, or rounded surface. Use these adjectives. Also, it might be possible to use automatic gestures, automatic recognition of gestures, because now our system is actually state-based, so now we know what we're doing. And also, it is possible to design a better laser pointer. So just to conclude my talk, I'll wrap up our contributions. So we have developed a large-scale dense mapping system that can operate in outdoor scenes in real time. We developed hardware that allows interactions at distance, and we can integrate sparse and accurate depth measurements to clean up the reconstructed model. And we have developed the very first prototype of a semantic mapping system for partially sighted people. Now I'll take your questions. I want to mention that this paper is actually part of a larger project focused on reconstruction and recognition of any environment, so feel free to check our other papers that we published this year, or our colleagues published this year. So thank you for your attention, and I'll happily answer your questions.
Thank you, Olga, and we have time for a few questions, one or two, so please line up if there are anybody eager to raise questions. Okay, until somebody's coming up, I have one or two. So you show this working outdoor under various lighting conditions. You talked about laser light, infrared light, maybe also a laser infrared light, I'm not sure. So how does the daylight or the lack of daylight affect the system?
Right, this is a very good question, because naturally, obviously, if the sensor is saturated, then you cannot do anything. But mostly it worked reasonably well. We didn't have major issues with it, but it's definitely possible to use a better laser pointer that would be more reliable, especially in direct sunlight. And there are some speculative effects and similar stuff.
Hi, it's great presentation. I'm Wang Zeyu from Peking University. And you know, there is a difference between labeling and semantic meaning. So in your work, is how do you create the semantic meaning? You by a user labeling, or you automatically detected?
Yes, the user provides the labels. So the user provides the labels he's interested in. So for himself, it has some semantic.
So have you considered about create a database and can detect the detect the concept automatically? Or is that a better way to make some improvements or?
Okay, so the standard approach in vision is that we use very large data sets with predefined labels, and we actually train, you know, offline these classifiers, and then actually there is that issue that your algorithm actually work only in environments for which you train them, because they do not generalize well into previously unseen objects, unseen environments, and similar.
Okay,
but
awesome.
Definitely, it might be interesting to try to actually discover this semantic knowledge automatically from in some unsupervised way.
Okay, great, thank you.
So thank you. Thank you.